How do you make a game about asymmetrical warfare? The inherently interactive nature of video games seems like a perfect fit to make you feel like an underdog or the favorite. Movies have successfully managed to recreate guerrilla warfare action and conditions. They show both the anger and despair of ragtag groups of patriots and the anxiety and paradoxical powerlessness of the occupying force. But guerrilla warfare is something that's hard to translate into a video game in its proper form. For example, Napoleon Total War has the Peninsular Campaign, the theater that gave guerrilla its name.
The Supreme Central Junta and its successor, the Supreme Regency, authorized the forming of local bands to fight guerrilla, the little war, against the invaders.
It tries to get you to use guerrilla tactics by giving vanguard deployment to most Spanish units and having lots of forests on the campaign map. However, the AI is so poor in the Total War series that using any type of tactics isn't necessary to beat it. Although I must admit that, because of its poorness, it has a terrible time dealing with actions behind the front line. How successful games are at making you the underdog is beyond this video, however, we'll be talking about the opposite side. On paper, forcing the AI to outsmart the player in order to win is a recipe for disaster. However, there's a little counterinsurgency game I want to talk about, Afghanistan 11. Brought to you by the creators of the very similar Vietnam 65 and the publisher of the excellent Battle Academy, this game takes you to the still ongoing conflict in the titular country. Let me be clear that unlike some other titles banking on current wars, this isn't a quick cash grab, but a quality project that's still receiving free updates from time to time. The settings really complements the gameplay. This is a far richer title than its Vietnam team predecessor, and the units and mechanics would not have flown this well together in an hypothetical Afghanistan 79. What's this game about? Well, it's about the American invasion of Afghanistan. While this game gets you in the shoes of a big technologically advanced occupying army, you will have a hard time feeling in control when you first launch a skirmish you're greeted by this. This is your HQ. From the safety of this base, you recruit units and try to take control of the map. A very famous concept regarding the occupation of foreign countries is winning hearts and minds.
There is, of course, another war to be won also. A war of words, hearts, and minds.
Joker, I've told you we run two basic stories here. Grunts who give half their pay to buy gooks, toothbrushes, and deodorants. Winning of hearts and minds, okay?
Como los contrarios nuestros en Vietnam decían. Ganar sus corazones y sus mentes.
Y perdieron, Ernesto.
It relates to being unable to fight a war without the support of the local population. You have a hearts and mind tracker on the UI. It tracks the average support of each village toward your cause. It starts at 50 and in 60 turns on the average settings has to end up being higher than 50. A modest goal, but the hardest one, believe me. The way to achieve this are plenty. Humanitarian aid is always appreciated, connecting villages to the highway, delivering UN supplies, or building water towers will make a village more favorable towards you, symbolized by the flag they raise. However, if you were to build infrastructure and waterworks, you are also expected to both defend it from the enemy and take care of maintenance. Killing the enemy and disarming the AEDs also send a clear message of who's winning. Conversely, losing troops or just fighting near the village will make them support the guerrillas. Randomly, the villages will have a chance of giving intel if visited by infantry, indicated by the lit fires. The more a village is cooperative, the higher the chance of giving you information. It's either the position of an enemy unit, IED, or poppy field. Yep, the locals might be growing opium. The profits are given to the Taliban and translate to more units. Destroying them is profitable, but the locals won't appreciate their newfound unemployment. You also have to get close to destroy them with either special forces or regular infantry. Artillery and airstrikes are powerless against the mighty opium fields. Winning hearts and minds this way is also important when it comes to the elections. Periodically, it will be election time and you will be competing with the Taliban on a candidate. Do the most good for the villages and your candidate will win, giving you some bonuses. What are their weapons? Just these guys. Underwhelming, huh? Well, the real weapons are stealth and sabotage. In a normal tile-based game, units have, you know, vision? Not in this game. When a cadre of terrorists spawn, either from the borders if they're Talibans or from hidden caves if they're militias, they have a mission to do. When completed, they're dispersed. They can either go in timid villages, place IDs, plant opium crops, ambush your troops, sabotage water towers or attack FOVs. Should the H&M score be low enough for too long, the Taliban will launch an offensive with technicals. Militia will always disperse if engaged. The Talibans will just fall back, fighting on even when injured like your own forces. You have a multitude of tools to deal with them. Huskies are the only vehicles with vision and will disarm IEDs automatically, making them ideal to lead convoys. Buffaloes are your engineers, they'll build roads, bridges, waterworks and FOBs. The Black Hawk and the Chinook are for transporting supplies and troops. The MRAP carries infantry around and the supply truck holds cargo. The howitzer is self-explanatory, it shoots. The Apache is the most powerful power projection tool available. It's able to safely blast from distance any enemy and moves at a breakneck pace. The infantry is for gathering intel and occasionally engaging in mountains. And lastly, the special operation team is your best friend. They can call warthogs on the enemies, snipe them from afar, set up listening posts for an ungodly amount of vision, and most importantly, train locals. They can train an helicopter, an howitzer and an MRAP equivalent in the HQ and infantry at the FOBs. Afghan infantry ranks up quicker than the US and they can eventually become special forces themselves. Why is this important? Well, after turn 45, everything except buffaloes, huskies, supply trucks and mortar packs up and goes home. If you're unprepared for the Taliban invasion when this happens, you won't have a great time. You might get caught without any Afghan special unit and thus unable to recruit any combat unit yourself, so you'll have to prepare. This creates a very interesting gameplay cycle. In the beginning, you'll stress out about making the most of your initial funds as you get as many villages as possible in your sphere of influence. You'll develop a sense of security and routine as special forces spot most guerrillas for the howitzer to blow up before they can do anything while you build up the Afghan National Army. Then, as the US withdraws, you scramble to make the most out of the meager forces you have left. You will, however, retain the three global abilities you had from the beginning. An airstrike, a drone scan and emergency supplies for either your troops or villages. Speaking of, logistics are an important part of this game. Every unit consumes either fuel or rations each turn. Howitzers and mortars need ammo delivered to them and FOBs have limited supplies to give away. This means you'll have to periodically haul supplies around to keep things firing or just alive. The HQ refuels and rearms units in one turn, while FOBs will only give your troops one turn worth of supply each turn if you don't want to use one of the FOBs. Yes, even the FOBs have their own supply to be delivered to them. So, FOBs are mostly there to make sure your troops can move further away from the HQ without starving, and also to house a mortar and possibly an howitzer or two. They're built with buffaloes and they can become as useful as your HQ if spent enough resource on. By the way, in this game you're not spending money, you're spending political points. They're an abstract representation of how the internal front is going. With each enemy killed, ID disabled and local support gained, you'll gain PPs. While having damaged units or losing engagements will result in the home population and politicians supporting the war less. This implies that the only reason why the US is saturating the countries with Apaches is because they don't feel like it. It's the most abstract element in the game and can lead to some hilarious situations where clearing roads of IEDs will net you the most money. However, I guess this is accurate enough. If it wasn't for the home front, the troops in Vietnam would have died for something. I guess the US has learned to wage popular wars. The game even has events that pop up from time to time with various consequences. Most are random, but some are caused by your action, like losing an helicopter. So that was the gameplay. Does this game represent guerrilla warfare properly? Considering that, A. If we had complete vision of the map, the game would be easy. B. The main challenge is in spotting the threats. And C. Our objective is to gain political control of the country, while the enemy's objective is to be a thorn in our side. I say that every single soldier, the devs, did a great job. I do, however, have a wish list for things that could be added. Tanks would be a great way to project power around bases while still retaining a different role from helicopters. Hind gunships for the Afghan army could provide both firepower and transport capabilities, kind of like a mix between the Black Hawk and the Apache. Scout helicopters are strangely absent from the US arsenal, although there might be some balanced reasons behind it. Some way to spend PPs on offensive units once the US army withdraws would be great, something like very expensive contractors. Downed pilot could also be a mechanics, they could refund some PPs or give veterancy to an helicopter similarly to Command and Conquer generals. Yep. Lastly, I wish the FOBs had a bit more vision, as they can be a bit of a death trap unless surrounded by special forces. The game does have a DLC, Royal Marines. It has a different and new kit of units to play with, as well as adding new mechanics like car bombs, roadblocks and local police, which in my opinion should have been added to the base game. I do not own this DLC, but it seems like it's worth its price if you enjoyed the main game. On the technical side, this game does great as well. I've only encountered some very minor graphical glitches, like these guys shooting with metal detectors. And maybe some campaign maps are a bit blinding with no option to lower the gamma. Speaking of, the options are extremely limited, but the essential is there. There's also no unit list like in other strategy games. The game does tell you which units you haven't moved, but you have to cycle through each of them. The sound is expectedly good and the soundtrack is nothing to write home about, but it doesn't have to be. The visual flair is amazing. You can instantly tell what unit a vehicle is holding by its color and flags. The bases will show on the map how much ammo and supplies they have left, and the cargo on logistic vehicles is always visible. Even the achievements are translated into the uniform screen, where you're shown them as medals and awards. So, should you buy this game? Depends. First of all, beside the extremely replayable skirmish mode, there's a campaign too. It follows some real events in the Afghan war and has 14 levels, 18 with the tutorials. They are a bit too long for my liking, but it's subjective. Free content has been added to this game already and will probably get some more free goodies. There's no multiplayer to speak of, however, managing logistics isn't for everyone. If you like what I've shown so far, then sure, get it. If you're on the fence because it looks complex, then I say give it a try when it's on sale. The UI is really user-friendly and the mechanics are easy to get used to once you get past the tutorial. I wish the devs the best of luck on future titles and I'll definitely keep an eye on them. Okay. Thanks for watching.
You American?
Pilot of the USA.
Yeah, well, what's the capital of Texas?
You got the map.
Wrong, commie. It's Houston.
They got my vehicle. I escaped.